Hello and welcome to another episode of our special series, Beating All Odds. In this series, we are recognizing, we are honoring leaders who, despite all the challenges and problems and glitches thrown at us by this lockdown, are ensuring that economy and our businesses remain active. They are trying to contain the damage that this crisis can cause. With me today is one such special leader, Mr. Navin Khemka, CEO, MediaCom South Asia. Mr. Khemka is very special because it's very difficult to catch him. It took me 3 years to get an interview with Mr. Khemka. So,
thank you so much for having me. Thank you so much. Yeah.
This is actually a very good time. Most of the times I would get replies like he's traveling, he's not available. Now I know all of you are at home. So
I know.
At least that level of excuses is gone.
At home, but not alone.
Yeah, and we have to all do household work also. So, sir, it's almost 2 weeks now that we are all at home, and we are almost entering the third week. What are the challenges, the main challenges that you have faced so far in running your business from home?
I would say we were actually we saw this coming, Naziya, to be very honest, because we were following this situation very closely in our global offices of China, which is where obviously it hit first. And we saw it coming, and therefore we were preparing ourselves for a lockdown like this almost 3 months in advance. So, you know, we took a lot of initiatives. Yeah, we took a lot of initiatives. When it started in China, so we actually took a lot of initiatives and learnings from our China market and our China offices. And you know, what we did was we actually started making sure that all our systems were checked for remote working. We also gave our entire staff, almost 80 to 90% of our staff before the lockdown started, we actually also gave them all laptops. In fact, the day of the lockdown, the day the lockdown got announced, and it was from midnight, that day we obviously didn't have any more laptops to give away. So we actually transferred all the remaining desktops to people's homes.
Okay.
So that was one thing that we did from a readiness point of view. And also from a systems point of view, we ensured that every system, you know, be it planning, be it all the tools, be it all the softwares, be it my entire billing system, everything was remotely functioning. And around the 12th or the 14th of March, we actually went on a national lockdown ourselves as a group, and we tested the entire system remotely. And so as when the lockdown happened, from a work point of view, we were very seamless. Obviously, we went a bit slow. We went a bit slow because, you know, systems are a bit slow and everybody does not have fiber or, you know, very good broadband connections at home. So it went a bit slow. But yes, from a compliance point of view, from a GST point of view, I think we are absolutely 100% compliant as we speak. And all our clients, whoever I reached out to and said that for the next 2-3 months, we'll be not sending physical bills, we'll be sending e-bills, and they are all GST compliant. So every client has actually come back and said that they really appreciate this move and they will accept not physical but digital bills going forward. So yeah, so I would say apart from not being in office, the office is almost functioning, I would say almost at 90% efficiency and 100% capacity.
Great. So you were even ahead the government.
Yeah, you know, we are in a service industry and we have to be prepared for the worst.
So this is, despite 90% efficiency from your side, I don't know how many clients are actively working right now. So particularly you have clients like Make My Trip, you have clients like Hilton. These industries have really been hit very hard by the crisis.
Yeah, you know, there are two.
Sorry,
complete your question, yeah?
No, I was asking, like, what kind of solutions are you working on for industries like these? Or what do you suggest to other agencies also for media, for hotels, tourism or travel industries?
So, yeah, you know, I would say two things. There are two scenarios. One is the pre-lockdown scenario and one is the post-lockdown scenario. In the pre-lockdown scenario, pretty much we were getting briefs from all clients, except for maybe the travel and the tourism and the retail. Those were the sectors which were obviously very hard hit. So those clients I'll deal separately. Pre-lockdown, we were pretty much working for all clients. We were working for fantastic campaigns in the April-May-June quarter, and that being the largest quarter for us, given that IPL happens in that quarter, and given that a lot of start of the financial year, we have a lot many more new campaigns planned. So things are pretty much normal. Once the lockdown got announced, and which means the entire country has gone into the lockdown, which means that, you know, the entire country is in lockdown, which means all shops and markets are closed, which means that even if people want to go and buy some products, they can't. So that is when the stress started, when all the briefs started drying up and all activities that were planned had to be pulled out, or no new activity was to, no new campaigns were to go on air, even though they were planned earlier. Basically led by the disruption, I would say two things. A, people sitting at home, obviously not having the opportunity to buy. And second thing is, obviously, given the fact that the entire supply chain in the country got disrupted with so many trucks and so many people got getting stranded on the highways and movement of goods between the states and the districts not allowed. So that is how the regular business got affected. And some of the categories that got affected, basically like you're rightly saying, the retail, the multiplexes, the hotel industry.
So particularly the travel industry, because Make My Trip is your client. Hilton is your client.
Absolutely.
These industries,
absolutely.
How long will they take to recover, or what kind of suggestions are you giving to these clients?
Yeah, so I think these clients, basically what we are telling them, and we are constantly in touch with them, and what we are telling them is, and they also realize that you know, when there's a big storm, and this is like a storm for that industry, you cannot fight that storm. Huh? There's nothing you can do about this. You have to just let the storm pass. Huh? So what we are telling them, that's right. So just hold your, just have patience, hold your horses. Do not get, do not take anything which is knee jerk. Make sure that your teams are together. Make sure your employees are together. Keep the morale high. Keep the employees engaged, and things will start looking up in the next 4 to 6 weeks.
What kind of engagement can you do at this time? You know, when your industry is shut.
No, so it's a good question, actually. So, we are, in fact, at MediaCom Group M, we are actively engaged with our teams. So apart from forming WhatsApp groups, obviously, which everyone I think would have done by now. So we have about 250 odd people, everybody in that one single WhatsApp group, and which is extremely active. That's one. The other things about what we are doing is at leadership level, we are connecting with our teams on a daily basis in the mornings and the evenings. Something unique that we have done, which now obviously everybody is appreciating within Group M and also globally. At MediaCom, we identified there are about 20 kids, 20 young people who joined MediaCom, who are actually what we are calling them home alone. What I mean by home alone is when the lockdown got announced, you know, they couldn't travel back home. And they are now stranded in Delhi, Bombay, Bangalore, staying all alone or staying with a roommate and obviously feeling lost. So we've actually created a group called the Home Alone Kids, and I'm engaging with them on a weekly basis. We've also connected them to a lot of people around them who did not know earlier, who are staying very close to them. So in case they need any help, so therefore they don't feel as if they are lonely. But they don't want to be called the Home Alone Kids. Yesterday, those kids told me that that's very boring. Mm-hmm. We want to be called Flying Solo. So that's what they have named them. They've named themselves Flying Solo.
And professionally, what kind of engagements are you people?
Yeah, so that's A, from a people point of view, just keeping them engaged. In fact, one more thing, we are also doing a lot of webinars. We are also doing a lot of training sessions. We are also doing some stand-up comedy acts.
Really?
We are getting some. Yeah, we are getting some stand-up comedians. So that's, people are really appreciating that. So that's more from an engagement point of view. So, and from a, I would say from a work point of view, I would say we are investing a lot of time in doing something which all of us always wanted to do and never had the time. So I would say we are upskilling them, we are reskilling them. People have been told to take at least one initiative every week. At least one, you know, we have hundreds and thousands of programs on our global pages, which are like training sessions. So everybody has said that every week they will do at least one of them, and they are maintaining a tracker, which all of us are tracking. So yeah, so A, I understand the work could be a bit less. I understand that we are all working remotely, but this is also the time to make sure that we are upskilling ourselves. And a lot of clients actually have reached out to me and said, can we organize some trainings for them? So we are also also trying to see what sort of training can we organize for some of our key clients.
Sir, Vivo is one of your very big client. And were you expecting something like IPL getting postponed or cancelled? I don't know. What kind of damage has it caused? Or... I just want to understand the scenario that what are you doing for Vivo right now, because it's the title sponsor of such a big property which has been which there's so much uncertainty about IPL now. So
you know, yeah, it's a fantastic question actually, and with Team Vivo we keep discussing it every day, in fact, as to what we should be doing. So you know, I think we as Vivo and MediaCom totally invested on IPL. What IPL has done for Vivo is unprecedented. Vivo is today a household brand name today in the country, right? In such a short span of time. And IPL has a huge role to play in that. So we are totally invested with the IPL, and we are in constant touch, the Team Vivo, with the BCCI to find out what are the solutions that we can offer. We definitely want IPL to happen, obviously in conducive environments. However, if IPL cannot happen in this quarter, so I'm sure between BCCI and Vivo, we will, you know, come to a conclusion as to when is the best time to hold this tournament, because everybody in the country looks forward to this tournament, A, because it's such a high viewership event, A, and also Vivo had a lot of launches planned around this event. So having said that, we are still gearing up for our launches as and when the lockdown goes down. And I'm sure...
Irrespective of IPL or only...
Yes, of course. No. So, you know, understand, there are two things. IPL is an opportunity for a launch. However, if IPL does not happen, the business has to go on. So therefore, there is a plan B also. In case IPL does not happen, what will we do in the next 3-4 months to make sure at least the 3 or 4 phones that are lined up for launches are done? And also that the stock that is getting piled up right now because of the lockdown, how are we going to liquidate that stock in a very short period of time? So yeah, there are multiple strategies being worked out as we speak right now. And I'm sure in the next two to three weeks, you will see a lot more of this taking shape.
We really look forward to IPL. It's more like a festival for the entire country. So you yeah, also absolutely. have PNG, you know, which is a consumer durable client, and it is the demand is still on. So what kind of strategy do you have for a client like this, which is irrespective of the lockdown, or people are still going out, they're still buying consumer products? So will PNG be still be advertising and spending on marketing right now?
Yeah, I would say on a client like PNG, which is obviously seeing no loss of demand right now, but it is life as usual there. I mean, the teams are working on, and PNG follows a July-June year. So therefore, this is the time when my teams actually work on the annual presentations, you know, category by category. We've been briefed for the next year and we are working on those annual presentations. And, you know, there's a lot of work happening from a July-June 2021 point of view. So that's one part of the story. And from an immediate point of view, apart, I think they will be absolutely fine as and when the supply gets restored. Apart from that, I don't think PNG as a client is facing any challenges. So A, the factory has to obviously, the factories have to restart, assuming one, and B, the supply chain has to get restored. Beyond that, I think it's pretty much work as usual on PNG. In fact, we are doing some fantastic work for them, for some of their brands, what we call as moment marketing now, especially for a brand like Wix. We have some very innovative stuff right now around the COVID-19. And trying to, you know, propagate social distancing, trying to propagate messaging in a very Vix sort of a way.
Talking in general, not just for your clients, this is the time when viewership is at its peak. You know, people are spending back numbers. We will have new back numbers today. News viewership has increased by some 200, 300 times. Even GEC, time spent on digital as well as TV has gone up. So,
yeah,
should... I mean, what sectors can take advantage of this and, you know, still advertise? Is PNG or consumer durables, or, I mean, I don't know, you would know better, which sectors can right now make use of this opportunity?
So, you know, I would say it is an opportunity. It is a media opportunity. But not necessarily it is a sales opportunity, right? Because everything outside is closed. Even if you look at it from an online perspective, even online players are seeing a lot of disruption in distribution in the, and how they will deliver and so on and so forth. So I would say yes, the opportunity is big because people are spending a lot of time on media, not necessarily would lead to sales. So therefore, one needs to be very careful. One needs to be very careful into how they want to invest money behind this opportunity. And I would say even brand building today, I would say one needs to be very careful because the environment, the mood, the mindset of people is extremely, extremely negative. So at this point in time, do you want to obviously build a brand? Do you want to build a new brand? Do you want to say that my brand is so good for you and so on and so forth? I'm not sure. So I'm saying, yeah, you have to be very careful, especially if you're an online brand, like a, I would say like a gaming app, or if you are a news app, or if you're a news brand who want obviously consumption to rise on your platform. So it's a fantastic opportunity because people have the time and they will sample your product.
You have a news app otherwise also. Daily Hunt is also your client, right?
Yes, of course, of course. So, you know, we have MPL, which is a very large gaming client, and we have Daily Hunt, and they are seeing unprecedented surge in traffic onto their apps. Unprecedented. So for them, I would say, yes, it is an opportunity because people have the time to sample their products and people have the time to spend on their apps. But for the others, I would say, yes, the opportunity is there, but it is not time to be opportunistic. It is time to exercise a lot of caution.
So this disruption has definitely will leave an impact on our economy. We still do not know how long will this go on. But looking at other markets, how much do you think this is going to impact? If you have to give some numbers, overall, how much will it slow down?
You know, I'm not the authority for this, but still, you know, I'm also reading what you guys
just
are reading.
Just an estimation.
Basically the, yeah, I would say the revised GDP is around 2%, 2.5%. So if that is the revised
GDP. I'm talking about our industry.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. If you now correlate the GDP to the to our industry, I would say assuming the GDP is at 2.5-3% this year from a growth point of view, then pretty much I think we are looking at wiping off all the growth that we are projecting this year at the bare minimum. So if we were projecting the growth of 8-10% for the entire industry, I would say assuming this quarter is the washout quarter, or this quarter is when things will not be so stable, and from July onwards possibly things will go back to normal, then I would say pretty much we can say that the growth that we are projecting for 2020, at least for this year, for 2020, is what is going to get wiped off. And in case we degrow as compared to what we did last year, then there are huge repercussions on the industry, and there are certain media which is already at a huge stress, which are not growing, which are actually degrowing. They are the ones who will see, face the maximum burn.
Are you referring to print sector?
No, I would not say. Yeah. So there are mediums which are under a lot of pressure. So today print is under pressure. Today outdoor is under such tremendous pressure because people are locked up at home. Today cinema is under so much of pressure because all cinema halls are closed. Yeah. So I'm saying yes. I mean, apart from TV and digital, I would say every other media will go through a huge amount of disruption. And as an industry, we'll have to then get together and see how we can, what we can do to save save all these media from going into a negative trajectory.
So before we close, I would want you to give a message to the industry about how can we really, all of us can come out of this situation despite all the problems and estimations that things are not going to be very good in next few months. What is that one thing that we can look up to and still hold ourselves?
Yeah, I think it's a very good question, and I keep thinking about this myself, and being responsible for almost, you know, as a group, we are responsible for 3,000 to 4,000 people directly, indirectly, on a day-to-day basis. We also feel very responsible towards everyone who works with us, and also obviously all our clients. So I would say the three things actually I think, and you know, which I keep telling everybody now, and I call it the three R's. Basically, I think we should be, we should respect everything. This is a huge lesson for everyone. We should respect everything human, non-human, irrespective of whatever small job that a person is doing, the time has come to realize how interdependent we are on each other. So respect everything and do not abuse the environment. That's one. Be responsible. I would say the second R is be responsible as a citizen. And everything is not about money. Everything is not about success. So we have to be responsible and we have to do things which are right for the society. And a third thing is restraint. I would say the third R. We might have all the money. We might have all the luxuries in life. But a little bit of restraint is good just to take care of everybody. So it's very important to follow these three principles and then ensure that we are leaving behind a fantastic company for our juniors or a fantastic world for our children. That's how you look at it.
And professionally, you know, people who have just started up or maybe young entrepreneurs who just started a new agency, what kind of piece of advice would you want to give them?
Yeah, actually, if you see, my heart actually goes out to them. Two sets, actually. Kids who've actually passed off class 12 and are waiting to start college. Kids who've actually passed out post-graduation are waiting to join new organizations, have job offers in hand or are looking for jobs. Those two communities. And the third one is obviously somebody who started a new setup. My heart actually goes out to them because I think they are the ones who are actually looking at life so positively. There's so much to look forward to, new job, getting into college, and suddenly life seems to be just being very cruel to them. So all I can tell them is that we are all here to help them. Please do reach out to us in case any of you are in trouble, and we will see how best we can help you. So anybody who's getting into anything new.
Thank you so much for your time, Mr. Khemka. And this was inspiring, and I'm sure a lot of youngsters would want to reach out to you for help after this. I wish you all the best. Stay at home and stay safe. And thank you so much for talking to Exchange for Media. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much. Stay safe and be in touch, please.
Thank you, sir.